the animal world is full of all sorts of amazing colors and patterns, and reptiles, with snakes specifically, seem to be some of the title holders for the most beautiful and vibrant and amazing colors. Now, one of the colors that is most truly sought after is blue, and true blue in nature is very, very rare. But today's species spotlight, we're gonna give it a go. This snake is one of the animals that is close to being true blue in the wild and is absolutely amazing and gorgeous and beautiful. So beautiful, in fact, that it's in the name. Today, we're gonna be talking about the Vietnamese blue beauty rat snake. Now, today is another one of the few ones that we went over. We went to my friend's place because they keep so many different species of really cool, very interesting, and sometimes hard to find and uncommon species of reptiles. So a lot of the video today comes from their collection and from their place with their amazing snake. Now, these guys obviously come from Vietnam. Their range is most of Vietnam, but they do spread into other parts of Southeast Asia. There are actually quite a few different subspecies of beauty snakes, and even a couple ones that are outside of their genus that are sometimes called beauty snakes. But the Vietnamese blue beauties seem to be the ones that are not only the most sought after, but the ones that I see most often in the trade. And so that's why I thought they deserve kind of their own species spotlight. Now, these guys actually belong to the genus Orthiopis, which I know, just like always, I mispronounce it. And that's what people get me on the most, is my pronunciation of things. And I really do my best. I really do. But that's just what is going to happen a lot. But I'll put it here as always. They were formerly part of the genus called Elaphe. So if you guys were just getting into the trade back in, you know, like the 90s, early 2000s, that's when Elaphe, almost every rat snake was Elaphe, and then they started to break it up because, I don't know, biologists just hate us or something. Maybe that's that little gap that they like to do. They like to keep, oh, we're the educated ones. You're just the people that sit over there and play with the snakes, although we're much better at reproducing them and monitoring their behavior. But anyway, we're not going to go down that road. These guys are really, really cool species of snake. They obviously get the name from the blue hues that they have. Now, true blue is, as I mentioned at the very beginning, it's very rare. There is really, I believe, only one animal in the world that in fact does have true blue, and that is a species of butterfly. There may or may not be a couple other insects on there, but I believe it's just one species of butterfly that does have true blue. These guys absolutely give it a go. It's more like a hueish gray color, and to that end, they are fairly variable in coloration, where they're not always that nice blue. However, they all do have a cool, nice gunmetal gray blue hue them from, as like kind of low expression, like to where it's close to like my Amarelli Argentinian cross boa, all the way up to those more blue animals. However, they all do seem to have, all seem to have this really nice kind of like diadem, almost like diamond shape of like whites that go down their body. They all have those like big black streaks that go across their face, over their eyes, that go towards the back of their heads. And they all usually have a very pale white to yellowish cream colored chin, under lower jaw, all the way down their body. Now, these guys, they've been in the trade for quite some time, but they were almost exclusively, just like a lot of the different species of snakes from Asia, Southeast Asia specifically, that were always wild caught. And they would come in as, you know, chronically dehydrated, fully loaded with parasites, very stressed off, very defensive, angry noodles that not only came, that gave them a reputation for being very angry, hard to work with snakes, but ones that were very hard to keep in general. However, thanks to a few people who really slogged it out those early years of different keeping snakes, we now have quite a few different ones that are in fact captive bred. And every year there are more and more captive bred, not only beauty snakes, but just snakes in general. We're still trying to dial in a few here and there. So that makes them so that they're much better captives and much better pet snakes. Now, that being said, they do kind of consistently earn the reputation for being much more defensive. Like all snakes, they do want to get away first. That's the very first defense they have, is to run away. However, it seems like the Blue Beauties seem to be much quicker to go to defend and hold your grounds mode than run away mode. And when they do that, they have some very iconic threat displays, where what they'll do is they will raise up sometimes more than a third of their body off the ground in that big S shape, they'll hold their mouth open, and they'll hiss. And sometimes, even when working and handling with them, even when they're not full-on hissing, leave-me-alone mode, they will sit there and they'll actually leave their mouth kind of open and almost like chew and work their jaw in a nice threat display to make them look more imposing. As you handle their animal more and more, they will start to acclimate to you more. However, I don't want to say that they're still an angry snake, but they definitely are a grumpy, moody one, and they definitely have their days to where, even though you see in some of these videos, it looks like he's going to take a pop and just nail our heads or faces, but he never did. He was absolutely great the entire time we were filming him. And that's just what they do. And that actually is the main reason why a lot of keepers never make the jump to keeping beauty snakes, the Blue Beauty specifically. It seems like probably just because it's the most popular one, that's the reason why they never really jump to that species. And they try to stick with more a companion animal when thinking of reptiles, with more of the more mainstream popular different species like ball pythons, corn snakes, and boas and things like that. Still a really, really cool, amazing species of snake. Them being from, you know, Southeast Asia, they like it warm, they like it humid. However, there's a thing with a lot of the species of snakes from Southeast Asia that end up being kind of considered the cool weather ones, like the rhino rat snakes, the greenbush rat snakes, the mandarin rat snakes. But then there's the beauty snakes that actually seem to like heat a little bit more. They like it a little bit warmer for the most part. Little generalization, but for the most part, all the different beauty snakes seem to like it a little bit more. And that's possibly because they're more active during the day. These guys are kind of all weather, all day snakes, to where they still have their periods of brumation and inactivity when it gets very, very hot in some places in their range, and also cold where most of the range it's still fairly warm because it's, you know, subtropical area, but it can get down into the low 50s. And so they get a little bit more inactive during those times. But because they seem to be up and active more often, they do like a little bit warmer temps. And so in contrast to, like, you know, the rhino rats and the mandarin rat snakes and the bamboo rat snakes, that all of those do occupy those same regions, they do like it a little bit warm. And so if you decide you do want to keep one, make sure you give them a, you know, not a hot basking spot, but, you know, one in the low 90s, as the fact that they are kind of all day, all weather, as I mentioned before, that they do like full spectrum lighting. They will bask, they'll seek out that UVA and UVB even separately from their little heat spots. They are semi-arboreal. They're often found when not coming out of farms and, you know, the wet markets. They are often found not only on the ground, they're found in the trees, sometimes fairly high up in the canopy. So give them plenty of space, because these guys are long colubrids. They average 6 to 7 feet, which I probably should have mentioned at the beginning of the video, but they do also frequently get longer than that. Specimens of 8 to 9 feet are not uncommon at all. So give them length and give them height, plenty of nice sturdy branches. They're not a heavy-bodied snake by any means. They're very slender, they're very agile, they're very fast, but you still want to make sure that you have very nice, strong, sturdy branches for them to move around on. Still plenty of hide boxes, both wet and cold throughout there. So just, you know, keeping in mind, a large adult specimen would make a great display animal, but that's a very large enclosure that you do have to keep in mind. We're talking minimum of 4, 5, 6 feet, and then 2 to 3 feet high, just in general. I don't like to get too much into specifics, as you know, but that's okay. They're just a really cool species of snake. And as you can see, my friends here who still working on their logo, their company name, I'm going to mention them every single time that I do a video with their animals, because that's what you do. You support your friends because they're nice enough to let me film their snakes. It's really, really nice of them. And as soon as they figure that out, I will retroactively go back and put their stuff into all the videos at the bottom in the description of every video that their animals were in. They're still a really, really cool species of snake. They're just not necessarily a beginner's snake, as with a lot of these different species. That doesn't necessarily mean they're a bad animal to keep in not only captivity, but even as a pet in general, for someone who's not a real collector or someone dedicating dedicating a lot of time, effort, and energy into breeding that specific type of animal. Just keep in mind that whenever you do decide you want to get one, always try to go for captive born and bred. There's still, you know, wild-caught animals that are coming in, but for someone who's not accustomed to that, the captive born and bred makes for a much stable captive, a much more hardy animal in general, as you acclimate them to your conditions, because everyone does it slightly different. We just try to take what our base knowledge of where they come from and how we've done so well in the past and try to do it the best we can in our own individual setups. So today, hopefully you guys enjoyed this video. I think these are really cool species of snake. I don't know necessarily if I will ever keep the blue beauty snakes, because this main snake building gets a little too warm for them for just kind of the ambient temps. And the cool room where I would keep them, even with a hot spot, because they do need larger enclosures, I don't really have the space for them, because my kind of Everest as far as the Southeast Asian rat snakes go are the Mullendorf or the hundred flower rat snake, which are arguably the one of the longest species of those type of rat snakes out there, sometimes getting over 8 feet long, even longer than averaging the beauty snakes. And so I need a very large enclosure for them, and that is going to take up a lot of dedicated room, you know, down the road. But as moving away from that, hopefully you guys did enjoy today's video. If you want to check out plenty of other species spotlights, if you want to learn more about different Asian rat snakes, I did plenty of those videos. I'll try to put them right here, both the playlist and the Asian rat snakes that can make good pet reptiles. If you can, please like and subscribe. It really helps me out. Again, thank you so much. Hopefully you enjoyed this video, and we'll check you next time.